Now he says unto Timothy, my own son in the faith. Now, notice that he is called Timothy and he's called Timotheus. And somebody's going to say, well, what difference does that make? Well, actually, it doesn't make too much difference. Only Timotheus is made up of two words, and it means that which is dear to God. And I think we need to see that, that this man was dear to God. He was dear to the Apostle Paul, and he was dear to the local churches of that day. What a wonderful picture that we have here. Let me say a word concerning him now. We have Timothy introduced to us, and we've had something to say about him before when we were in the book of Acts. Also, when we were looking at, for instance, the epistle to the Ephesians, then the epistle to the Philippians. Now, his father was a Greek. We'll see that when we get a little farther along. And his grandmother, Lois, and his mother, Eunice, were Christians before him. He lived in Lystra, and that was where Paul was stoned, and I think raised from the dead, by the way. And I'm not sure, but what this had a lot to do with the conversion of young Timothy. Now, he probably is like any other young man, rather skeptical, but I'm sure that convinced him, and he became an avowed follower of Paul after his conversion. And he was a man that had a good reputation, by the way. We're told in Acts 16, beginning at verse 2, well reported of by the brethren that were at Lystra and Iconium. Him would Paul have to go forth with him, and took and circumcised him because of the Jews which were in those quarters, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. And as they went through the cities, they delivered them the decrees for to keep that were ordained to the apostles and elders which were at Jerusalem. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. And then as he followed the apostle Paul, he became one that Paul had utmost confidence in. And Paul had in the churches many that proved false brethren that deceived him. That's always the tragedy, I think, of every pastor, is the fact that you do have wonderful people, wonderful friends in the church. I tell you, one of the glories of my ministry today is that right here in Pasadena, I began serving here in 1940, and I've been here a long time. And there are people that I meet, oh, just everywhere. We came to the Lord way back in 1940, 41, 42, and they are following in the Lord's steps, and they're loyal, faithful friends. That's one of the reasons we keep our headquarters here. We got a world of wonderful friends, you see, in this area. People you can trust. And Paul had those that he couldn't trust, but Timothy he could. And in Philippians, the second chapter, verse 19, listen to what he says there. I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. But ye know the proof of him, that as a son with the Father, he hath served with me in the gospel. Him therefore I hope to send presently, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. But I trust in the Lord that I also myself shall come shortly. Now, we find here that Timothy, you see, is one very close to Paul. And Paul here mentions that, unto Timothy, my own son in the faith. And that could be translated, my true son in the faith, or my genuine son in the faith. Paul had led him to the Lord. Now he says to him, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. And somebody says, well, that's just like the introductions we've had before. No, it isn't. I beg to differ with you. And the difference is this. Yes, we've had grace before, and we've had peace mentioned before. And we've spoken on those too. But friends, we got another word here. That's mercy. Well, what is the mercy of God? Well, actually, mercy is a word that was used back in the Old Testament, and it actually was equivalent to the word grace, because it was the mercy seat back there. And it was the sacrifice that made the throne of God, which is holy and righteous and just, makes it a mercy seat. And when you and I come to God, we don't want justice. What we want is mercy, and we need mercy from God. Now, mercy is what God has provided for all of his creatures. God's got all the mercy that you need. You can call upon it, but it's just like money in the bank. My friend will do you no good unless you write a check, and you write the check of faith. And believe me, when I write a check, I write it by faith a lot of times because it's not always there. But very frankly, that's what mercy is. God is rich in mercy, we're told. We've seen that one before. He has plenty of it. But when God saves you, he saves you by his grace. Now, God's merciful to you. God's merciful to all these sinners that are in the world today that blaspheme him and repudiate him and turn their back on him. God's merciful to them. He sends rain on the just and unjust. He doesn't play favorites, even with those of his own. Sinners today get rich. They prosper. They seem to do better than anybody else. God's merciful to them. But you see, you'll have to come by faith and write the check of faith. You'll have to come by faith, and then God will save you by his grace. Now, you see, these three words, love and mercy and grace, are a little trinity. Love is that in God which existed before he would care to exercise mercy or grace. God was love. That's his nature. It's his attribute. Now, mercy is that in God which provided for the need of sinful man. And grace is that also in him which acts freely to save because all the demands of holiness has been satisfied. So that God, because he's merciful, you can come to him and by his grace, he'll save you. You don't have to bring anything. In fact, you bring nothing because anything you bring is filthy rags. Now, I've read several letters from people who criticize me for talking about do-gooders. Now, my friend, a do-gooder is one that thinks he does not need the mercy of God. He feels that his own good works will save him. I had a man years ago, right up here in Altadena and here in Pasadena. He said to me, and he was on his deathbed, he said to me, he says, "Preacher, you don't need to talk to me about that I need Christ as a Savior and that I need the mercy and the grace of God. I don't need it. I'm willing to stand before him just like I am." You see, and you know what he told me? He told me what all he did. He'd been chairman or president, I think, of the community chest, and he had headed up, and he was head of an orphan's home at one time or chairman of the board. Oh, he was a do-gooder. And he's going to stand before God on that. My friend, let me say to you, do good salvation won't do you any good when you really need it. The salvation that God provides for you will enable you to do good, the kind of good that is acceptable to God, because even the righteousness of man is filthy rags in his sight. Now, the salutation here that Paul put down, the salutation is different from any that Paul had written heretofore. That is, there are none that you find back in the other epistles quite like it. And you're going to find through this epistle and these pastoral epistles, 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus, expressions that Paul does not use anywhere else. He obviously talked to these young preachers and those that were intimate with him in a way in which probably he did not always speak publicly. Wouldn't you love to have been Timothy, to have traveled with Paul, have this great apostle open his mind and his heart to you, talk to you in such an intimate way? Well, he's talking to you and me. That is, Paul's not. He's gone. But the Spirit of God is here. And it's actually God that's talking to us today through this epistle that Paul wrote to a young preacher. These expressions that we find here and the great truth that's here just something for you and me today. It's quite intimate. It's very personal. And yet, being personal, it has to do with the local church. It has to do with the body of believers as it manifests itself in the community. And that's the way the church should manifest itself. And I believe, therefore, that every believer should be identified with some church. Now, someone is going to say, that's the pastor that's in you. I think maybe you're right. That's true. Now, last time we got through this brief salutation, I had to hurry at the end where it says, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, he says that Timothy here is his own son in the faith, but God is our father, Paul's father, and he's Timothy's father, and he's your father if you've received Christ. And he's my father because I have received Christ. And I've been brought into the family of God, and now what a privilege it is. And you must remember, Paul had been a Pharisee, and in Judaism, he'd never had the privilege of calling God his Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, that is something we may bypass. That is something that, as we said last time, is so needful today that anyone in the church, any function you have in the church, anything that you do in the local church, you are to do it not only in the name of Christ, but you are to do it at His command. Remember, He is the head of the church. He's the Lord. And He made the statement. He said, you call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do the things that I say. You don't obey me. I wonder if He might not say that to many of us today. We just don't call Him Lord. He says many in that day are going to say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do this, that, and the other thing? We were busy as termites for you. And He's going to say, well, I don't even know you. I didn't know you were doing that in my name. You certainly didn't go about it that way. You didn't seek my will. You didn't seek to obey me.